John Deutsch.
Good to see you again.
You know, buddy.
Yes, yeah.
He was combing the Japanese cameras.
Mr. President, what do you think of MX missiles in the Minuteman?
Some of my best friends are in.
You think this plan will have congressional support?
So my question's photo op.
Next, please.
I'm not saying hello individually because I know we're going to move by the door and have a picture. Get through here.
Mr. President, as you know, these are members of the National Federation of Independent Unions. They represent 70 independent organizations and approximately 75,000 workers throughout the United States. They were very supportive of you in 1980 and endorsed your candidacy and have been very supportive of your approaches to the economy and to national defense. We're delighted they're here today and we look forward to it.
I remember 1980 very well with gratitude.
I'm not as good at this as you are, Mr. President, so I can't just shoot it right out. I can read it off. We appreciate you taking the time. We come to express our thanks and your efforts to control the situation. Your attempts to balance the budget, which has served on the budget committee, and to replace the rhetoric with action in the area of civil rights. Until a few years ago, the light at the end of the tunnel, we focused on coming greater. Thanks to you and your administration, our view has changed. I want to thank you. I want you to know that the National Federation of Independent Unions will do everything within its power to help you stay the course. Also, we would come to help you more specifically. You are not hearing from a potentially tremendous labor force, the independent unions of this country. Because independent unions are in the plants and on the jobs daily. They are closer to the thinking of the average worker. Theirs is the true voice of organized labor. The true voice that you do not hear. The voice that's not felt at first from some power brokers. Labor power. We can help you to hear this voice. It is the aim of the NFIU to unite all the independent unions in this country. One banner, thereby making better communication between government and this tremendous leader for us. Mr. President, because of you and members of your cabinet, particularly Mr. Donovan, our voice is being heard at last. With your continued support, we look forward to years of growth and prosperity and service to our country and to our members. Our many thanks are expressed by this plaque that brings with us its deepest respect and admiration for you.
Thank you very much. Rand, thank you very much. I'm most grateful for this. I'm very honored. And I know that the Vice President feels as I do about the support that we had from him in 1980. And, incidentally, thank you also for the article in Independent News and for the remarks about unemployment and retraining. I know that unemployment is still unacceptably high in the country, and yet, just since December, it's down 0.5 percentage point on its way, hopefully, to single digit and below. And we've extended, as you know, the childless benefits to, and the measures to encourage new, the creation of new jobs. We've sent the legislature bills that would assist in displaced workers in a program for job vouchers, so that a person could take his unemployment insurance as a job voucher and take it to an employer who would then get a tax credit for that amount for hiring this individual into a regular job, and that would last for a period of time of the unemployment insurance. We think that the job market is only going to improve as the economy improves. That's why we've fought hard against any of the usual temporary quick fixes that we've seen in the past recessions. And we think now that we are beginning to see a result. An 8-month decline, a straight 8 months now in the mortgage interest rates, the lowest it's been since September of 1980. The leading indicators, February, we're up to the 6th straight month in a row. And housing starts are now at 1.7 million, and that is also higher than they've been in several years. The best help, I think, for bringing that economic recovery is reducing federal spending. And I'm having this checked out now, but I believe the figure, with all the talk today about the deficit, and Lord, we hate the deficit as much as anyone else, and we're going to try to get them down. But some of those voices that are raised with regard to the deficit are ignoring the fact that if they had given us the budget cuts we asked for, 82 and 83, they would reduce this deficit by about $40 billion or more. That's how many of our reductions that we didn't get. So I think it ill behooves some of them to criticize the idea of having a deficit when they themselves were the ones who wouldn't go along with the efforts to reduce it. But our goal is going to be one in which people can earn a fair wage, where they can have homes and raise their families in freedom and security. And I know that we have your support in that and those goals, and I thank you very much for it. Ray or George, you
say amen.
President, I had the opportunity to address this wonderful group this morning, and the key points of my talk were how great individualism and independence has served this nation, and this group epitomizes, I think, what made America great.
I do too.
I think the same thing just that
I was struck particularly, I must say, by your words about not being brokered through other people and a kind of a power. Years ago, the union, of course, that I was president of and the guild was an ALO-CIO union. And there came a time back then when the graduated income tax was such that it was a very definite contributor to unemployment in the picture business. People would, stars would agree to make a picture, but would not accept another picture when they were only getting 6 cents on the dollar because of the income tax. So as president of that guild, I came back here to support an income tax reform bill that was before the Congress. I was representing 32 unions and management, all united together for me to come back and make this case before the House Ways and Means Committee. I might say that appearing before that committee was a little like going over Niagara Falls in a barrel, the hard way, upstream. But I have never forgotten at that time that when I arrived here, I was greeted by two representatives of the AFL-CIO, and they handed me a book. And the book was the AFL-CIO tax policy for the year. It did not advocate what I was advocating. It called for about $12 billion more in taxes because they had $12 billion in social reforms that they wanted passed. And they thought I'd like to have that before I went in to see the committee. And I said to them, I'm representing 32 AFL-CIO unions, and none of us have ever seen this. And no one ever asked us if this is what we wanted as a tax policy. But I was sent back here to support an opposition, and that's what I'm going to go ahead and do. And it is true. I think there is an increasing wide gap between the rank and file worker and the hierarchy of that organization. And I think that you are a blessed breath of freedom and representation of the worker, that you march in lockstep together, not as they do, taking divergent paths. And I'm grateful for that. And I think all of working America should be.
We appreciate you. I'd like to say one thing, Mr. President, if I may. We as the independent workers, and I come from Michigan, where in my county there's 22% unemployment. We are not coming here as an independent organization to ask you what you can do for us. We're here to tell you that we know that unions share an equal responsibility in the future of this country and the survival of our situation. We're here to support you, help you, and we hope you will tell us what you need done, and we'll go out and be your workers to do it, to get this country back on its feet.
God bless you. That is the proper approach. The man who originally created what became the American Federation of Labor, Samuel Gompers, said that labor must never forget their partners in the whole workforce and the industrial community, and one can't prosper without the other. I think he'd be a little disappointed today, some of those in organized labor. But I'm very honored and grateful for this. We are too. Now, this
photo op
out in Tunisia, and then to Egypt, and then to Saudi Arabia, and finally to Turkey. And the primary reason I asked for this meeting was to convey to you personally the message that was given to me by President Mubarak and the Crown Prince Abdullah Saudi Arabia. I realize that the discussions have been intense on the Middle East recently, and you may have gotten messages also from those same people or others, but I promised them that I would deliver the message personally, and they were very emphatic. So I'm here today to deliver that message, and that's probably the prime responsibility, and I have one other subject that I would primarily on that.
Right to it. I know you probably haven't any idea.
Not at all.
Well, I thank you for joining us in discussing the arms resolution before the House. And I think we share concerns that motivate a nuclear freeze. But however well-intentioned the freeze at current levels is called for in the Slovakia resolution to do, I believe, more harm than good. First and foremost, it would send precisely the wrong signal to the Soviets, who by their own account are neither unilateralists nor philanthropists. How can we expect to make further progress toward arms relations if the Soviets have no incentive to reduce? I think we can do better than a freeze. In the talks in Geneva, we've proposed a 50% cut in strategic missiles and elimination of the entire class of intermediate missiles in the INF discussions. And it'd be best to have none than some of these interned missiles, but as I said recently, if there must be some, well, it's better to have few than many. We've made some progress, and I believe we can achieve more. It was NATO's interned missile deployment plan that brought the Soviets to the negotiating table. In START, the Soviets have already gone further in discussing reductions than they have in any prior negotiations going all the way back to World War II. I think a freeze would remove Soviet incentives to agree to reductions and be virtually impossible to verify. the freeze supporters disagreed among themselves during the House debate in March over what is to be frozen. A freeze risks undercutting our long due modernization program. And we therefore oppose any freeze first resolution and support a bipartisan Broomfield Price Stratton resolution, which expresses support for ongoing nuclear arms reduction negotiations in Geneva, followed by a freeze at equal and substantially reduced levels. We hope this resolution will receive wide bipartisan support, as did a similar resolution which passed the House last summer. I also urge you to support the amendments that deal with issues of modernization and dual-purpose weapon systems, those that have a conventional and a nuclear capability, and any other amendments that correct the major flaws in the Zablocki resolution. And I hope that you tell your colleagues that I am totally committed to substantial, verifiable, equitable, and militarily significant reductions. I have been since before I got here. I still am, and Sunday in some of the shows that were on the air, I was disturbed to hear people saying that I'm insincere with this one. If I am, I've gone an awful long way to carry my insincerity in the Soviet Union. I think a freeze resolution just simply sends the wrong message to friends and foes alike. And now I'm going to ask George Bush and Cal. George, as you know, Vice President went to Europe last year to meet with all our allies on these very subjects, and particularly the INF. And
Mr. President, I would only add that when I went on that trip to Europe and then PS trip to a non-basing, the trip was to the basing countries and then up to Canada, which is an important country, was under its leadership under fire from some of the groups on testing. But in all those countries, all the seven countries,
go to the right or go to the left. He must be
Mr. President, as you know, we called this group together on very short notice to come to this meeting today to discuss the issue of withholding. And the spokesman for the group, there are two, William Kennedy, the president of the American Bankers, and the chairman of the National Bank of Commerce, and Paul Fryer, the chairman of the United States Legal Savings.
Well, I thank you all for coming here and doing so on such short notice. Let me just, I know you, as you know, withholding is coming up in the Senate soon, and I wanted to take this opportunity to discuss it with you. I welcome your views, but I hope you'll remember that old saying that the best way to get the last word in is to say, I agree. We spent months around this table figuring out how to fashion a budget that was fair and balanced. And one thing I needed to get the budget cuts, we must have to have a revenue component. If I turn around now and give up on the revenue side of the budget, the rest is jeopardized. We could lose the spending cuts we need, the tax cuts that stimulate business, and we'd send a signal that I back down when the going gets rough. I regret that this issue is straining our relationship, but it's a question of defending a principle that those who owe taxes must pay their taxes rather than asking those who are already paying to pay more. It's not just a problem of reporting, it's a problem of collecting, and withholding is the most effective collection method we have. It isn't workable to collect taxes just through reporting. That would require as much as a 200% increase in audits. And we want less, not more, IRS involvement in the people's lives. Consider the alternatives, higher deficits or new taxes. You don't want either one of those, and neither do I. The Congress is looking for ways to spend more, not save more. And I just can't step aside and let those issues go because there's political opposition. I know we disagree, and I want to hear your point of view. I just hope that the recovery that is beginning, we can cooperate our positive actions to stimulate growth and prosperity by keeping spending down and lowering interest rates, instead of fighting within the family over issues that should have remained settled once decided. Let's have some more words before we open to discussion here.